This is the official start of the journey. I've just arrived at Thun and I'm heading to Interlaken. At Interlaken, I'm going to meet my friend Helen from New Zealand, who's there already, and then we'll continue our journey together. So, day one, Thun to Interlaken. So, I've just come up the mountain by about 750 meters of ascent, and hopefully, I think that's probably the last bit of climbing, hopefully, and hopefully there'll be a great downhill. Just got an amazing view of this lake and mountains. Almost there, almost at Interlaken, end of our first day. What an amazing route. As you can see, it's just spectacular. Hi, this is day two of the trip, and we're cycling from Interlaken to Grindelwald, and there's only one way and it's uphill all the way. I've been joined by Helen. Helen is from New Zealand and Helen is cycling around Europe. She arrived in Rotterdam, was it 3 weeks ago?
Yeah.
And she cycled all the way through Holland and Germany and into Switzerland, and we've met at Interlaken. So the weather is diabolical.
It was great yesterday. Got a great view of the Eiger and the Monk and Jungfrau, but today there's no view, just the rain.
So it's just keep on plodding upwards. So this is day three and we're heading from Grindelwald to a town called Meringen, and it's over a pass at 1962 meters, which means we've got about 900 meters of climbing today and about 35 kilometers. Now the weather is absolutely appalling. Rained all last night, it's raining now. Views are limited, surrounded by spectacular mountains that we can't see. It's thundering and it's been lightning. That's the forecast for the next 2 days.
Nice work, Andy.
How are you enjoying the bike ride so far today, Helen?
It's amazing. Wouldn't want to be anywhere else in the world. But a little bit of sunshine would be nice.
So we've just reached the top of the
Scheidegg.
Grosser Scheidegg or something. We've just reached the top of this pass.
1962 metres.
Yeah, and we've just come over. We've come up in the torrential rain. Soaking wet. The rain has relented a little bit, And there's a cow that's about to attack us, so... But we just come over the pass and we've got an incredible view and the clouds clearing. And Helen is going to zoom down this descent and I'm going to film her, so... Just been chased off by these two cows behind me. Look at them. They're not very happy. It's coming to get me. I better go.
Andy had a stand up with a cow. Warming my face in the sun. The sun's come out. Things are starting to dry out. I still feel very sodden and cold, but it's bloody nice to see the sun. It's been a cold day.
What about these mountains? That is just unbelievable.
Amazing.
We're in heaven. We're in heaven again. It's just... I don't know how many times I've been in mountains and suffered rain and wind and tough work to come over the other side and just see nature in its most magnificent splendour. You can't get over it. It's just amazing. See you later.
Hey, have fun. Yep.
Now, today is day 6, and what a day we have in store today. You can see part of the route behind me. I'm going to take this road all the way down there, to the village in the bottom called Gletsch, and then I'm going to ride all the way up and up and up and up and up and up to the Furka Pass down the other side. Okay, so here we go. Descended 400 metres in 11 minutes. And that was one of the most thrilling things I've ever done. That was incredible. I'm now at Gletsch, and behind me is the mountain that I'm now going to have to cycle up. It's going to take a lot longer than 11 minutes. I think that's going to be at least another 2 hours, and I'll still be plodding up there. So, amazing. Let's get going. So I'm about halfway up the ascent now. The gradient's really easy, it's only about 7%. Cruising along at a nice speed and having a fantastic time. Wonderful, wonderful riding. Steady 670 meters of climbing, not too difficult, and a new view awaits around the corner. So it's nice, fast downhill now to Andermatt. Beautiful. So let's go. Let's have a look around this corner, see what it's like. Come on, baby. Round we go. Beautifully scope around the mountain. So this is day 7 of the cycle tour, and today I am cycling from Andermatt to Dennitzis, and I'm going to go over the Oberalp Pass, which is at 2,044 metres, a steady climb of about 550 metres. Quite a leisurely stroll, one would say. Yep, looking forward to another great day and some new mountains over the other side of the pass. Just coming out of the village, turning right and heading up to the Oberalp Pass. Cycling with their two-year-old child in a buggy. Fantastic. So I'm about halfway up the Oberalp Pass, and a new landscape's opening out. It's absolutely incredible, so beautiful. So that's it, I've arrived at the Oberalp Pass, fantastic ride, and now to descend on the other side and see what the next views are like. This is day 8 of the tour, and today I'm cycling from Danitzis to Chur, and it's about 65 kilometres. There are no major passes today, maybe 300 or 400 metres of climbing and some good cycling ahead. About two-thirds of the way to Chur now, and I've just stopped for lunch. This beautiful spot by the road. It's been quite an easy day today. Just going up a nice hill now. I want to tell you a story about this bike that I'm riding. Now this bike is quite a special bike, and it belonged to my brother Tony. And I'll explain the story of this bike to you now. Today is a very important and significant day. It's now 5.5 years since our Tony was killed, and the possessions and the bicycle that he had with him at the time have been in police custody since. They kept them for the trials as evidence. And today they have finally released these things to us. So it's going to be difficult, but I'm prepared to do it. I want that bicycle, and I want it to tell this story. I want to bring it back to life, if I can. Well, I've just collected the bike and I brought it back home, and it's wrapped in brown paper, so I'm going to unwrap it and have a look at it. So the reason I want this bike, and the reason I'm hoping to repair it and bring it back to life, is because this bike is very important. This bike tells a story, and it speaks for our Tony. It was a vital piece of evidence in court, and it told a story that our Tony himself couldn't tell. Now, when our Tony was killed at the scene, the bike wasn't there. We just assumed it would be. But the police told us 2 days after that the bike had been found, and we thought, what do you mean it's been found? We didn't know it wasn't at the scene. And the bike was found 6 miles away, and it had been thrown over a crash barrier onto a grass verge. Now, the driver claimed he knew nothing of the collision. He heard nothing. He felt no bumps, no vibrations, no sounds. He didn't see anything, and he proceeded to drive away. Now, tachograph evidence showed that he had stayed, pulled into the lay-by in which this bike was found. Police experts examined the bike and come to the only conclusion that was possible, that this bike had not actually been run over. And the only way that this bike could have come out from the lorry was if it had been pulled out. So the lorry driver had stopped in the lay-by, pulled into the lay-by, and he had got out of his cab, and he physically pulled the bike from underneath the lorry and threw it over the barrier. And he said his defense was that the bicycle must have just fallen out. So it's being dragged along, he stops, becomes stationary, and it just falls out. Now, this bike was evidence that that was impossible for it to happen. If the bike had fallen out onto the floor underneath his lorry, as he pulled out, his 40-ton vehicle would have run over the bike. And this frame would have been buckled. The police collision expert, who has seen many of these bikes run over by vehicles and lorries, says that the bikes come out banana-shaped, they're buckled. And as you can see, this frame is perfectly straight. It hasn't been run over by a lorry. So, that's the story it tells. And I'm hoping that because the frame is straight, because it's relatively undamaged compared to what it's been through, I'm hoping that we can repair it and I can get this on the road again. So let's take the bike to the bike specialist now and see if it can be repaired.
There's just a few things preserved. The frame is relatively okay. The rear triangle is out of track, but this can be what we call cold setting, basically you just bend and tweak the frame back to how it should be, so it's all in a straight line. The forks are, they're not out, or they don't seem to be out, but we'll probably be able to tell better when we get the bike to bits. The saddle, amazingly, isn't damaged. Things like the bars have just been dragged along and basically ripped off, ground down basically. The handlebar stem is savable, but I'd happily restore this bike. It's a nice old Dawes bike. It's of good quality. This will ride again, this bike. This will go again. It basically just needs a fair bit of time and sympathy. Yeah, it's come out well, Andy. It's to say what it was like when it came through the front door. It's now a very usable bike. It's something you can use anytime now, anytime, anywhere, really.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, the chassis is, the frame is straight now. The components that were damaged, they're all gone. There's lots of new components, but there's still bits which are original.
The brakes are still the original brakes, aren't
they? They are, yeah.
The stem. The forks.
Yes.
The frame.
The seat.
The seat.
Amazingly, which is totally intact, yeah. And the seat pin.
Yeah.
But the majority of the, even the rear derailleur's original, but the front one isn't. So this is original, but that one's not.
So the derailleur survived.
That derailleur survived, believe it or not.
That is unbelievable. Yeah. I'll definitely use it. I'm going to use it for a triathlon this year. I'm training to do a triathlon.
Right.
And I'm going to do a cycle tour with it.
We're just right. But that's really what it was designed for, that type of use.
Yeah. Thank you so much for it. I really do. Thank you. It's absolutely amazing.
Pleasure, Andy.
It's all right.
A pleasure.
You know, I'm absolutely delighted with this. That man, Gary Proud of Kendall Cycles, has been absolutely amazing. It's people like him who own small businesses and small independent cycle shops that do an absolutely amazing service for cyclists. And, you know, we really need to do everything we can to keep these people in business. His love of cycling and, you know, the attention and effort he's put into restoring this bike is just incredible, and I can't thank him enough. And it also, you know, just goes to show that, you know, the cycling community, they're a special group of people. Most of them will do anything for anyone, and, you know, they don't really deserve to be treated with such disregard, disrespect and carelessness on our roads. It's beautiful. The bike is beautiful, and our Tony would absolutely be delighted that this has pulled through. I'm now going to use it. Here it is, the bike's all loaded up. I've got my front bag with all my valuables and stuff on. I've got my water bottle and got my panniers, got my tent, my helmet, my two flags, my adopted country Mongolia and Great Britain. Our Tony's bike is doing brilliant. It's a strong, strongly built machine, powered by me, of course, but it's doing a great job, and I'm sure that our Tony would absolutely love to be here on this trip with me, and he's inspiring me every step of the way. I think about him. So we're now at the end of day 10 of the cycling tour. I've fast-forwarded a couple of days. I've cycled from Chur onto Landquart, and then from Landquart to St. Margareten. And from St. Margareten, I've cycled here to the final destination, which is Kreuzlingen. So that was about an extra 170 kilometres. My experiences of cycling in Switzerland have been amazing. This country is set up, geared up completely towards cycling. The last couple of days in particular, I've seen hundreds and hundreds of cyclists. The paths, the cycle routes, and the signposting is incredible. They've got 9 national routes all over the country and hundreds of regional routes, and the signposting is so accurate, it's so amazing that you hardly ever even need to navigate. Every single little junction in every single place is signposted. It's phenomenal. The only time I've been lost is when I've actually missed a sign and cycled straight past it and had to re-find it. It is amazing. The major towns have got fantastic cycle paths, separated from traffic. The routes take you off-road, away from the main roads. The only times I've shared the main roads was when we were coming down and over the Alpine passes a few days ago. You come into villages and towns and town centres, and there's huge cycle parks with hundreds of bikes parked up. People just ride up to a shop and just leave the bikes outside. They're not stolen. They're not locked. Hundreds of people. The entire country is a fantastic example of you know, how you know a great attitude and a great organisation towards cycling makes it safer for them. You actually feel safer when you're cycling. You feel that, you know, you're supposed to be on the road. You're supposed to be there. It's set up for you, and it gives you a lot more confidence, and you feel safer, and you know that the traffic, the motorists, they're there. They expect cyclists to be there. So yeah, it's been a fantastic experience coming here and enjoying this amazing cycle tour. So yeah, that's it. I've had a great time, and hope you've enjoyed this little film. So thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you later. Bye.